thankful that we look at, which is really important. Just to preface, my co-author, Amma Kaufman, left here, and she's my smarter, better half, who has taught me almost everything I know about copyright law in India. Mm-hmm. So I'm going to try my very best to convey all of her brilliance to you today. Our paper today is called Entitled the Future of Music Streaming Business Practices in Copyright Management in India. For those of you who have the title, we changed the title of the practice, business practices versus not business models, and I'll soon reveal why we had to do this. I don't know how to make this work properly.
It's a PDF.
Okay, good. So we start in the context of kind of the evolution of music distribution technologies. And I just found this infographic really funny because you see kind of these disruptive technologies in music distribution. Starting from analog to digital downloads in the iTunes master area. So now we're in this cloud-based streaming. And kind of our Indian counterparts to iTunes would be formerly a Goosebumps Light music store, which was under the umbrella of Flipkart. And today we have these major streaming services that are kind of like the Spotify Indian equivalents of Saavn, Gaana, Hangama, Zingaana, etc. However, in the past few years, we've seen a lot of these services collapse, and the question is why. Not only have we seen a lot of services collapse, we've seen a lot of random kind of intermediaries come up, but this being telecom operators, device manufacturers, internet service providers, mobile applications, getting into the music distribution space. So we asked ourselves, given these new players, these new complexities of stakeholders, what is the impact of these new distribution technologies and these stakeholders on business models, licensing practices, and copyright management and institutions in India? So we're starting off from the music streaming model. And the music streaming model today is largely something called freemium, which is what the industry terms as a starting point that feels like free access, where you don't actually have to pay anything, but it's ad-supported, but it's invisible that data charges and bandwidth charges that you're still incurring. And then you have the option of a premium paid subscription, which formerly meant that you didn't have to pay, you didn't have to see ads, and increasingly these quasi-download caching capabilities that allow you to listen to mobile music offline, provided you pay the subscription. And this is kind of a revolutionary thing because music has never come to a price point that competed with piracy. And now, we have access for those formerly priced out of the market in addition to those who could geographically access it, of course assuming that bandwidth and all of those things are accessible. So this is instrumental for music access and unprecedented consumption of music is occurring today. This is also incredible because it's moving a formerly illicit demographic of music listeners into the legal music market and actually theoretically, allegedly paying rights holders their due. And then via the mobile phone, India is a very interesting case study because it's a mobile first market. And meanwhile, the entire world is converging towards a mobile phone as a music listening device. And industry theorists say because of limited storage, 18-month life cycle, and Modi's really exciting Digital India campaign, which is expanding bandwidth to tier 2 and 3 cities, ensuring every Indian has a smartphone by 2019, it's theorized that the future of music access is streaming via the mobile phone. So given all of these different kind of distribution mechanisms, we broadly categorize it into two ecosystems. The first way is the telecom-supported / device-embedded ecosystem. And this is important because both these models have access to consumers' attention and wallet. Wallet meaning they have access to the direct payment channel being the mobile phone credit and or their credit card. And attention because the device itself already has it pre-programmed into the service or the telecom operator is pushing these services. So an example is like Sony Music Jive where you get this program within Sony computers or phones. Or Airtel's new Wink streaming service, where you can only access it if you're an Airtel subscriber. Standalone online services don't have this kind of exclusive restriction, but they also don't have a direct access the payment channel. And what's a little bit dangerous, which we'll learn why, is they have an increased kind of potential consumer base, which means a lot of people might use it, but are they paying? We're not really sure. So that being said, this is kind of the left side of the revenue content flow right now, where, you know, both the telecom device company funds the platform, and the content goes to the device owners. And on the standalone online side, we have advertisers and, more importantly, investors who are supporting the funding of these platforms. And what's interesting is that in India, the only surviving streaming platform today have been backed by either angel investors in the US or big media companies like Times of India backing Ghana or Intel backing Kangama, amongst other people. So what's interesting here is also the Feels Like Free listeners aren't actually paying for any content, but they are receiving content. And so, you know, the question of valuation of music, the question of value of content versus carrier is really important in this phenomenon. So it's free too good to be true. Kind of the three broad main criticisms of the streaming freemium model is that it's one, intrinsically unprofitable. So there was a study by Generator Report saying that, you know, it's impossible to maintain a profitable margin. And like I mentioned, a lot of survivors in India have corporate backing. To our knowledge, no streaming service has made a profit to date. If anyone has counter evidence, please do let us know, because that would really change things. The second is that it replaces music sales and doesn't actually help the industry grow. But as I mentioned, it's bringing an entirely new demographic. So, you know, we have to also analyze the pros and cons of that. And the third main criticism today, if anyone's been following Taylor Swift in the US, she recently pulled her catalog off of Spotify. Funny enough, her album was number one on Pirate Bay after that. So, you know, this is an interesting debate of whether or not artists and songwriters are getting paid their dues. But so the industry is largely saying, you know, we can no longer have free music. This is not a profitable business model. We have to start charging people. But is this true for India, particularly in such a price-sensitive market? Are people really willing to pay? Is the business model really flawed? I wish I could tell you. And it's really difficult to determine, and this is largely our kind of main suggestion, is that it's impossible to actually assess any of these claims because we don't have a data transparency within India's music industry. There's an unsustainable cost of content because of a trust deficit among stakeholders. That's our first claim. Second is that there's a lack of legitimacy amongst the copyright institutions, being the Copyright Act and the Copyright Society. And there's just a lot of misunderstanding and confusion within what the amendment is actually supposed to do. So, moving back to these models, we're revealing more of kind of the distribution chain. We have the film music, which is largely what we're focusing on because film is about 60% of music consumed in India today. And it's important to know that these characters called content aggregators arose when digitization of music was first starting to happen. And these content aggregators basically said, okay, we'll digitize your content for you because you don't have these in-house capabilities. And in response, we're going to maximize your revenues because we're going to put you on all these different platforms and make sure that you're technically compatible with them. And so, but during the Color Ring Back Tunes boom, everybody made a lot of money. Because Color Ring Back Tunes was largely what a lot of people say India's music industry survived off of. And funny enough, let me just say before that, increasingly today, music labels now have the technical capabilities and digital in-house capabilities, so they're opting to go direct to platform. The other reason is because there's less intermediaries kind of in the middle. And this is important when we look at the problem of content acquisition. So the issue was when these new kind of innovative services were trying to acquire content, music labels largely monopolized ones like labels with a lot of content were charging these extortionate rates. One news site says that webcasters, which are these internet platforms, invested 150 crores. This is not including operating costs, but they're still unprofitable because of they paid over 500% of their revenues in licensing. Now, in the West, this is often seen as a royalty kind of problem, where Spotify is paying 70% of their revenue. And they only have 30 to actually function. But here, it seems that it's more a problem of these huge advanced lump sum that doesn't even account for the usage and exact plays of music itself. And because these labels have a monopoly over their content, not only are they charging these extortionate rates, but they're also kind of collectively giving certain pieces of their content to different platforms, which means that no single platform has all of their catalog. And a lot of times this is a purely speculative kind of practice, because one, they don't trust the business model, which, okay, understandable, but two, they also don't trust each other. And this was this is because of a question of obfuscation and falsification of data. And this has actually proven to be true because they found that telecom operators were fudging their telecom ringtone numbers, which meant that when they were supposed to pay back the money, everybody was kind of cutting down the numbers and nobody really trusted each other. So when there were these technical solutions to provide more transparent data, although they found that their music was being played more, in theory you would think that, okay, we're going to, you know, maybe ask for more royalty or ask for more return, but the music labels just increase their minimum guarantees by 50% time, which largely, you know, behind the kind of official, oh, piracy killed us, according to Flight's MP3 store, people say it's because of this huge minimum guarantee that the producers could no longer afford. And so these costs kind of replicate down the value chain. You have the music label setting that rate, and then everything else is like extraordinary. But then the music labels are saying that this actually begins from the film producers, and then the film producers claim that lyricists and composers are the ones that charge a lot. So in order to find out then where the money is really going and whether, you know, this amazing legal-free revenues are really flowing down the value chain to the lyricists and the artists, it's important to understand the intellectual property within IP. Now this is vastly simplified, mostly for me, but I hope also helpful for everybody here, is that within Indian copyright law, Section 17 says that the author of the work is the first owner of the work. So this is really important. Whenever a creative person or lyricist writes lyrics, they are the first owner of that copyright. Similarly, for the composer, for the ones who write the song, the music producer for the sound recording, and the performer for kind of their performance in the recording. These rights all have royalty due now because of the amendment. And we'll go through a little bit of that later, but it's important just to remember that this is kind of within India's law, a natural kind of a due right. And then these copyright societies are these institutions that are meant to redistribute royalty, protect their copyright, and essentially, collect for exploitation of the work. I really hate that word, but it's essentially the usage of any of the music, underlying works, etc. And they also are supposed to work internationally with other institutions and collect money on other corporate societies' behalf and return those royalty flows. And this is also meant to provide kind of a single window access to licensing. So formerly, and not anymore, we'll talk about why these platforms could go to these societies and say, I want all of your regional content, or I want all of your film content. And it would be a blanket license that they could easily get for free, or not for free, but easily acquire for a single kind of thing. And some of the kind of recognizable ones, Indian Performing Rights Societies, Public Performance Limited, and a new Indian Singers Rights Association. You'll note that there's asterisks on the first two because these kind of existence of these societies are kind of in question. Partly why is because in a really great investigative piece that I'm not going to go over by Prashant Reddy is he titled it a royalty heist. Which was a collusion and kind of corruption between music labels and copyright societies, which after several, not illegal, my co-author Amba corrected me, not illegal, but just bad in law amendments that essentially took away the first ownership rights from the lyricists and the composers. And this was because in the 1977 judging between FPRS and the East Indian Motion Pictures Association, the Supreme Court said that the film producer commissioned lyricists and composers, so it's a work for hire. And so that meant that, you know, the film producer was the first owner of the copyright, hence they don't really, you know, deserve any royalties because it's not theirs. And, you know, some music label executives have told me, you know, it's the film producer has conceived the idea of their head. They know the music they want, they know the storyline and the song. And so in his mind, it was, you know, his creative idea. But as anyone who's a kind of copyright 101 would know, there's no copyright in an idea. It's merely the execution of an idea, fixing it onto a format that you can protect it. And so that is, thank you. So basically, the lyricist and composers lost their rights, the film producer had it. Oftentimes, the film producers would then sell their rights to the music label. And in 1993, there was a memorandum of understanding, basically like a written agreement saying that IPRS would include music labels into their societies as publishers. And in India, publishers doesn't really exist because the written notation of music hasn't really taken off in the West. And so music labels largely kind of just took that on. But through a series of voting amendments and voting rights, they actually linked the voting rights to the number of works owned rather than the individual itself. So obviously, music labels have a vast catalog of rights, and so they would essentially always be in the majority of the voting rights in the board of directors. And thus, music labels effectively have complete control of this copyright society that's supposed to protect the work of composers and lyricist members. So the 2012 Copyright Amendment Act was meant to correct this, and the lyricists and composers and singers and basically creative fraternity became really frustrated because during the Color Ring Back Tune boom, a lot of these labels and technical telecom operators were making huge amounts of money, and they weren't receiving the royalties to any of this for the past 3 decades. So the two main significant amendments here was the non-transmissible right to royalty, which meant that these creative folks had a lifetime right to royalty. You could not sign it away. And if they had any clause in their contract that said they would give their right to royalty away, it was essentially null and void as illegal. And performers actually also kind of got, even though they weren't huge on the lobbyist side, they were also talking about this grievance for many years, and they also had this new right to royalty. And on an equal basis is a kind of debated part, but largely it's already been defined as distributed equally between the publisher and the their associates, etc. And then secondly, mandatorily functioning through a registered copyright society was essentially meant to correct the mismanagement of these copyright societies, and it was meant to provide more regulatory oversight to ensure that they were actually collecting and distributing the funds. And this also, Section 30 also stated that you need to pre-register within 8 years of the amendment, which, because that didn't happen, we are kind of in flux of who's supposed to collect these things and what and how. So largely, if kind of in the amendment following world, this would be kind of how music IP and rights would be administered. We have the sound recording. Just forget the rights section for a second, because we took that out because it was complicated even for me. And typically, the sound recording is owned by the music label once they produce it. And it would typically, it's supposed to be administered by, some sort of sound recording corporate society. In India, it would have been PPL. Sound recording performers, we have this new copyright society called the Indian Singers' Rights Association, and they would collect it for them. And the underlying musical and literary work would be the authors, the composers, lyricists by the institution that's supposed to protect composer lyricist members. So, again, in the Thank You Amendment following world, we would have this kind of situation where you have a singular society collecting an exclusive type of right, and this essentially makes the whole scene a lot simpler, right? You wouldn't have to kind of figure out, like, unlike the U.S., where you kind of have to choose between multiple performing rights organizations, you can just go to three, or in the case of New Zealand, which is even greater, I think you go to one single corporate society for everything, and it's not as complex or crazy as this. So in the kind of online platform streaming world, this would be the case. So post-amendment has things actually... Okay, I have 30 seconds now?
Yeah, 1 minute.
Okay, perfect. So in the post-amendment update, copyright societies, what's happening to them? IPRSL and PPL deregistered, and this is really exciting and kind of crazy, but there was this investigation that was supposed to happen, because they were supposed to investigate where all of this money went. So they sent a letter that was leaked a few months ago to this really popular intellectual property blog that said, actually, you didn't register us, because IPRS has submitted re-registration, and then the copyright board said, oh, you know, your documents are erroneous for whatever reason. So they had to resubmit documentation. And when they were then called for investigation, they said, actually, we're no longer corporate societies. We're operating under the Companies Act, therefore we're a private limited company. And so, you know, we're not taking any funding, so you can't, you know, investigate us. So then these use of authorized agents came around. So these two big film industries, Shimaru Limited and Yashraj Films, started using this company called Novex Public Communications out of there. It's a copyright society, essentially. They were doing business with licensing and issuing, etc. And this went to the court because, you know, in the previous amendment, we said that the business of licensing had to mandatorily function through registered societies, which meant, but then there was another, right under the copyright kind of ownership section, that says anyone can authorize an agent to license copyright for them. So this is typically meant, like, if you pass on and you give your copyright to, like, a family member who can then continue that business of issuing and copyright management. And this went up to the Supreme Court or Delhi High Court, one of the courts, which effectively said, yes, you can still do this, but not under your name. So Novex was essentially issuing copyright under Novex itself, but they basically have to, I mean, it seems to me like kind of a technical ruling. They just have to explicitly say, you know, this is Shimaru Film licensing this song, not Novex itself. So it seems now that there isn't much teeth in the mandatory copyright kind of issue, mandatorily functioning through copyright society. And these authorized agents are popping up as, you know, an alternative because really nobody wants to function through formerly mismanaged society. Secondly, performance royalties, like I mentioned, have been recognized. So the Indian Singers' Rights Association is the first and currently only registered copyright society in India, and they have recently gotten an ex parte injunction, which basically said they went to this establishment and said, we want royalties for the song that you're playing because our singers are in it, and they didn't show up, so the judge said, okay, you're right, they have to get a license in order to play your music, which is, you know, incredible because now they have a little more grounding to their deserved rights. However, there's been a lot of constitutional challenges, one in part because, you know, one music label executive told me, like, what is a singer's right? Singer's rights doesn't exist anywhere in the world, but somebody in India asked for it, and so there it is. So, you know, I mean, it actually does exist kind of under performer's rights, but he was just very skeptical of kind of their existence. And some say this is an example of copyright fragmentation, where there's just kind of too many different rights that so many different people own, and, you know, how are we going to navigate all this complexity? But other constitutional challenges have been, one, unreasonable restriction on the right to trade and carry out business, saying this prevents the freedom to choose how to license your right. So this was speaking earlier to the amendment saying you have to mandatorily function. Now, given this authorized agents thing, perhaps that's not the case, so we'd have to go back and check whether it really limits that unreasonable restriction. And interestingly enough, the Bhojpuri artist, and I would love to talk to you about this, because my father said this may have been something that the music label put them up to, but they had a constitutionality challenge saying that this right to royalty reduces their kind of advance. Because essentially, if you were getting, let's say, I don't know, 100, I'm really bad with Indian movies, sorry, but if you're getting a lump sum, having to account for the right to royalty meant that advance would be smaller. And, you know, a lot of, like you said, live performance and essentially a lot of these artists became more financially insecure because of this new clause, or so they claim. So the conclusion is mainly that, you know, the viability of these business models and the viability of digital music distribution is extremely important, and we would love to understand, especially in India context, if you know, whether it's a feasible business model. But it's impossible to determine because we don't have data, accurate data. We don't have transparency in number of plays. We don't have transparency in whether these copyright revenue flows are going through. And copyright management is just in a big flux. And so, when we're talking about media or just anyone, I mean, this copyright law is supposed to apply for anyone in the music industry, and you know, royalty flows apply to not just music but other kind of creative industries. So just kind of on a broader picture, I think it's really important that we kind of understand how conference should be managed, whether we should have a more simplified model like the New Zealand where you have one single institution, or whether we should be like the US where, you know, you allow competition to ensure quality control. And so some of these bigger questions is something that we're going to have to look at, and it's going to be the second phase of our study for this paper.